Drive 105.
There's no business like show business, like no business I know. Everything about it is appealing.
Good evening, legendary!
Nowhere could you get that happy feeling when you are stealing.
You're tuned to Drive 105.3 FM. This is Bill Wattles, the Culture Vulture.
People, they smile when they are alone.
It's Thursday night.
They told you you would not.
Just gone 7:30.
Night you open,
and earlier than usual, it's the music from the musicals.
Understand.
Hour and, well, whatever. And yes, let's get on with the show. I'm delighted to say that I am joined in the studio, not as a guest, but as a co-presenter. I have the lovely local Derry girl singing, international singing sensation, Margaret Keys. Margaret, very good evening and welcome to Drive 105.
Very good evening, Bill. I am very, very excited. Very excited. This is something I've wanted to do for a very long time. It doesn't matter what stage I've performed in the world. This is the highlight of my life.
This
at the moment.
Was really? This is a big moment for both
big
of us, then.
Big moment.
And you were, well, we've been talking about doing this for quite some time.
Yes.
And then just last week, and we've put this together.
Mm-hmm.
I'm saying we've put this together. We've got a very special guest coming on in about half an hour's time.
We do indeed,
and
absolutely.
I've got you to thank for that. Yes, folks, boys and girls, ladies and gentlemen, delighted and honoured to announce that Marti Webb, Mrs. West End herself, will be joining us here on air round about 8:05. So much more of that later on. Thank you very much for that ever important advice. Right, our next track this evening is a track that was, it was a show that was written by Andrew Lloyd Webber and a gentleman called, lyrics by a guy called Don Black, and it was called Tell Me on a Sunday, and this is the title track, and it's by a lady called Marti Webb. And I've explained to you that we might be talking to Marti and not that too far away.
I don't want to fight day and night, and enough.
think we have Marti on the line now.
Marti, are you there for us?
Yes, I am, Margaret. I'm
Hello,
here.
Hello, Marti. What an absolute pleasure to have you on with us this evening. We're just completely in awe and delighted that you were able to join us.
That's my pleasure.
Marti, listen, it has been a coup because you are known as Mrs. West End. You really are. You are the Mrs. West End, and we met a few times, and I've watched you on stage. I've listened to you from a very young age, and you have been an inspiration and a complete icon. But can I ask, was it something that you always wanted to do as a young girl?
Well, I don't know. I don't think I ever really thought about it. I always sang, and I enjoyed it, and I danced, which I loved. And then I got the chance to go to a stage school, and I think that's when my fate was sealed. Because as soon as I got there, we were taught that this was a job we were going for. It wasn't just fun and laughter and all that. It was actually serious. We were actually being trained to do a job, which I'm very grateful to, actually, years later. So I suppose then I did want to do it. I did, and I realised there was an opportunity that I could do it, maybe.
And did you go to training, or how did you begin? Did you actually train? I know you went for an audition at the age of 15 years. We were talking about this, Bill.
Sound of Music.
And the iconic Lionel Bart was in the audition panel. Tell us about that.
Oh, that was when I did Stop the World. I wanted to get off with Anthony Newley.
Yes.
And I went for the audition for that. And I'd been to so many auditions. It's one of those things, you know, you just keep going to audition. They go, thank you so much, and you don't get them. So you go to the next audition. So by the time I went for this audition, I was getting quite used to this. And so I sung my song, and I went to walk off. And I've never forgotten this. I felt so embarrassed because Tony knew. He said, do you think you could possibly sing another song for us?
Oh, God. Then
I felt so stupid, I can't tell you. And I thought, oh, my God, that's how you've really done it. And there were people laughing. I could hear people laughing. And I couldn't understand why they were laughing. And so I sung another song. And I remember it was from Seven Brides for Seven Brothers. Wonderful, wonderful. Well, and I couldn't remember any of the words at the end. And I went, wonderful, 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 wonderful day. Because I couldn't remember anything. I was so thrown by the fact people were laughing. And I could hear them. They were in the distance. Anyway, it turned out it was Lionel Bart, Alma Cogan, Lionel Blair. Mm-hmm. And all these people were sat there with Tony. And I thought, I've really blown it now. And he was very nice, went out. And then I got a call back, which I was very surprised at, with some other people from my school. And we were in the bar at the Savile Theatre in London. And Tony Newley walked past. And he went, hello, Mark. And I went, oh, hello. And he walked past me. And we said, oh, do you know him? And I went, no. I don't know him at all. And that's really how it started. And he was just so friendly. Yeah. And he said, you were so funny. Because he said, you were obviously put out. He said, because we asked you to sing another song. And we thought that was so funny. He said, then the more we laughed, he said, the more angry you got. He said, and it was so funny. He said, you were just funny.
And you were memorable to them. I think that's important in an audition, that you are memorable. But obviously your voice spoke volumes as well.
The right reasons, though, one feels. No, but they were lovely, and it actually helped me because they built up my part all the time in Stop the World. I started with quite a small part, and I got extra things to do in the show, which was lovely.
Yeah. But do you think that, you know, obviously you worked really... I know myself, you do lots of auditions at a very young age, and you're just constantly doing one after the other. But then that break comes, and do you think that it was Andrew Lloyd Webber and Don Black that gave you that break after you kind of were... You were doing Evita at the time, am I right?
Yes, that's right. Well, I suppose I got my break very early on. I suppose you could say Stop the World, and then doing Half a Sixpence, where I started opposite Tommy Steele. So I suppose that was a huge break for me. But then, you know, as it happens, you don't get much and you do bits and pieces. Then I did Oliver, I did a tour of Oliver, and then I did other shows. And then eventually, when I came to Evita, I never went for Evita originally because they weren't seeing anybody over 25. And I think I was 33 at the time. And so, you know, and they just always, you go for auditions, you know, they ask for certain people and things like that. As it was a leading lady, I would have gone for it. But they said, no, she's too old. No, we don't want to see her. Mm-hmm. And it so happened that I went to see the show, and I saw the show, and I thought it was wonderful. Elaine was brilliant, absolutely brilliant. And then a friend of mine who I was with was convinced that I should play it because I looked like Ava Perón. And she got a bee in a bonnet about that. And so you made me go and have these photographs done as Ava Perón.
Really?
Yeah, so I had these photographs done, and I wore a wig, which we got from one of the wig companies.
Yeah.
And it was actually Ernie Wise's wig that he'd worn as one of the Andrew sisters.
That was amazing.
I know, it's just funny things that happen to you. And so I had these photos taken, and my friend Angela Richards, she gave it to Gary Bond, who was then playing Shay in London, and he had them in his dressing room. And Hal Prince came in and said, "Oh, I haven't seen those pictures of Ava." And he said, "That's because it's not Ava Perron." And he went, "No, it is, don't be stupid." And he went, "No, it's not, it's Marti Webb." He said, "Can she sing?" And Gary said, yeah, she's a good singer. He said, "Oh, right." And that was that. And the next thing I hear is that I'm asked to go and sing for Andrew.
In his home?
In his home. And so I go along there, and I remember my friend phoned me and said, "Now, for God's sake, we know you can talk for England, but, you know, he's shy. Don't speak too much." And I thought, oh, God, I was so nervous when I got there. Anyway, yeah. He opened the door and never stopped talking.
He didn't stop talking.
No,
and what did you sing for him?
We talked about musicals and all the shows he'd seen and things. And he'd actually seen me in Half a Sixpence, would you believe?
He had, right.
So it was sort of one of those things. And then he said, "Oh, I suppose you better sing for me." And he sat down at the piano, and, of course, he played for me, and I sung the songs from Evita, which was amazing, absolutely amazing. I mean, you know, to hear him play, he plays it quite different to anyone else.
Yeah.
You know, and it's lovely. It's just so lovely.
And do you think that it was at that moment that he decided that you were going to be the lead in Tell Me on a Sunday? Do you think it was very early on that he knew that?
I think it was sort of in his brain. I think it was in his mind, because as I left him, he said, "You obviously sing in my keys." And I said, "Oh, you write in mine." And,
fantastic.
And then as I got out the door, he said, "If I write something I think you'd be right for, would you sing it for me?" And I just thought, what a nice way of saying, "Don't you phone us, we'll phone you."
Yeah.
You know, as you do, because you can't think anything's going to come of it. Well, he kept his word, because I had to go back and audition, and I kept auditioning for Evita. And, of course, they didn't know then whether Elaine would go to Broadway.
Yeah.
So I was up to take over from her if she went to Broadway.
Mm-hmm.
And as it was, of course, as we know, she didn't.
Yeah.
So I went in for her for a month.
Mm-hmm.
And I'd only been there a week when Andrew took me out to dinner with Don Black.
Mm-hmm.
And through coffees, they said to me, "Well, we've been working on a project. So we've only written a couple of songs. And we wondered if you sing it for us." So, yeah. I mean, what do you say? No?
Yeah, absolutely.
You sit there, and it's almost like an out-of-body experience. Because you can't believe that somebody's saying this to you, somebody like Andrew Lloyd Webber.
Mm-hmm.
And that's literally how we started with Tell Me on a Sunday.
Wonderful. And amazing. It was a one-woman show, so it was very intimate.
It was. And, I mean, the best of it was, because it was like my first big recording, I'd never really done a lot of recording, I was lucky because it was only Andrew and Don and the musicians. That was all. There wasn't a lot of producers and people shouting us or anything. It was very intimate. The whole thing was intimate.
Mm-hmm.
And I stayed at Andrew's house so I could work with him during the day. Then a car would take me to the theatre and bring me back so I could work with him. And Don would come over and he'd work on the lyrics and whatever. And then we'd go in the studio and record the song with the musicians, which was amazing for me, you know, who hadn't done any recording. It was absolutely incredible. And I learnt so much from those musicians. They were wonderful, absolutely amazing musicians.
And obviously the song, the iconic song that came from Tell Me on a Sunday was Take That Look Off Your Face. So, and that actually charted in the pop charts. You were on Top of the Pops.
That's right, yes. Well, that was funny because we hadn't actually done Take That Look Off Your Face. We finished the album as we thought. And Andrew said, "We've got a few more minutes on the session. Is there anything else?" And Don said, "Well, what about that song, You Must Be Mistaken?" And Andrew said, "Oh, yes. Oh, yes, that was quite nice." He said, "Do you know that, Martin?" And I said, yes, I remember hearing it. And then it was just taken off with John Mole on the bass, picked up this riff, and John Heisman on the drums went, 1, 2, 3, and it just took itself off. It more or less did it itself. It just became Take That Look Off Your Face as we know it now.
Yeah.
And I just sung it along with the musicians, you know, who were so wonderful. And and who can believe? And there was nowhere to put it in the piece because we'd call it. So Andrew said, "Oh, we'll put it at the beginning."
And that was it.
Yeah.
A huge hit.
There was something that's actually quite remarkable. I feel as though I shouldn't be calling you Marti. I should be calling you Miss Webb.
Oh, there we go.
But when Margaret told me that yesterday or the day before that you were going to come on the show, I couldn't believe, because I actually played Take That Look Off Your Face on my show the previous day.
Oh, how funny.
I had already played it. And, you know, would you mind, shall we play it again?
You can if you like.
We're going to play it now. You stay on the line, please, Marti, and we'll chat a little bit. Yeah, please, God, we don't lose you again.
You must be mistaken. It couldn't have been. You couldn't have seen him yesterday. He's doing some deal up in Baltimore now. Must be mistaken, I'm sure that you are. There's more than one car with stickers on, and lots of young guys wear corduroy pants, and I'd know if he hadn't gone. Take that look off your face. Close my eyes, there's only a woman can. No, I didn't dig deep.
No, I didn't dig deep.
I did not wanna know.
I did not wanna know.
Well, you don't interfere when you're scared of the things you might hear. When he's back, you think I will end it right there and then. Well, my farewell to friend, you're wrong.
That look off your face from the One Woman Show, Tell Me on a Sunday, starring Marti Webb, who is on the line with us here in Drive 105. Marti, that was fantastic. Thank you so much.
Oh, I didn't sing it then. Only the record did.
Tell me, you know, well, you've talked about you played Eva Peron and Evita, but you were Grisabella and Cats.
That's right.
And Anna and the King and I.
That's right, I loved that. That really was, because it was Rodgers and Hammerstein, which, of course, when I was a kid, I always wanted to do Rodgers and Hammerstein. Never thought I would, so to do King and I was wonderful.
Amazing.
I also did Oklahoma, but, you know, I don't feel the Farmer and the Cowhand is quite on the score of the King and I. You know, there's so many beautiful songs in that. And it's a wonderful part too, Mrs. Anna. I was surprised, because I'd never seen the show. I'd only ever seen the film.
Right.
And when I did the show, I was surprised how great the acting scenes were. And how great it was! It was just a fabulous show to be in. It really was.
And when I was looking back at your career, I stumbled across. I actually saw you in 2008 in Manchester.
Oh right,
Mrs. Johnson.
Ah, yes, in Blood Brothers.
In Blood Brothers, yeah. I've seen that. So I haven't seen it as often as I've seen Liam. We were talking just before we came on air. In fact, we were talking on air. I've seen Liam as 69 times.
Oh, my God.
I think I like it.
You don't know it by now.
The jury's out. I know it in French. But Blood Brothers is one of my favourite musicals.
And, oh, it's so fantastic.
And, yeah, I did. I saw you in the Palace Theatre in Manchester because I definitely saw it in 2008. So it must have been you because that's when you toured.
That's right, yes.
So of all of these roles that you have played, these lead roles that you've played, Marti, do you have a favourite?
No, because it would be unfair. You can't really put them beside each other. I mean, Mrs. Johnson is a wonderful role, but so is Anna in The King and I. And so is Evita, you know, you can't put that right there. I just think I'm so lucky to have played these wonderful roles. And they're all roles you could get your teeth into. You could actually really enjoy and play them. You know, there was a character there, a real character, which was fantastic.
Can I put a politician's hat on and ask you, if you were to play one of these parts again, which one would it be?
Oh, no, don't say that.
No, I won't. I won't put you on the spot.
But they are all very, very different roles.
Absolutely,
and I think that's
yeah.
what's so key about how you can approach the different roles very well, Marti. And I think that's why you've longevity in your career, because you can do so many different things. Would you agree with that?
I suppose so. And I think that's been the joy of it. I've never played really the same sort of part. They've all been so interesting. And I think that's what it is. If you have an interesting part to do, it keeps your interest. I mean, you can do it for like 2 years, a stint or whatever, because you're interested in the part that you play. So it's never that you're always striving to do it better or to find things in it. You know, so people always worry about us doing like 8 performances a week, or doesn't it get boring? It's the same thing you do. But it's never the same because the audience aren't the same. You're not the same. You don't feel the same.
No.
And everybody else you're working with too, it feels different. So mm-hmm. it's always something new. Every time you step out there, it's something new. And that is the joy of live theatre.
And do you have a regime any way you warm up?
No. You know this, Margaret.
I do know this. You see, we talked about this last week, and I said, Marti, I believe, because I obviously being a vocalist, it's been inbred in me that we have to warm up before we sing.
Mm-hmm. Well, I wouldn't advise anyone not to warm
up,
I have to say that.
Yes.
But I do have a band call usually, you know, when we're going anywhere, if we're doing concerts and things like that. As far as shows are concerned, I always find you sing yourself into them, because most of them you actually do. The first songs are actually, you know, to sing you into it.
Yeah.
And then off you go. And you know in yourself, as you do, when you stand there, you know whether you're going to be able to sing tonight or not.
Yeah. You don't get nervous, Marti. I never really see you nervous.
Oh, but I'm always petrified.
I've never been nervous.
I know, it's one of those things people say, oh, you look so confident, and I think, how? I know, I'm shaking like a leaf.
No, because I watched you from the theatre. I've sat in, we've done a show together, we did 2, I think, together, and I sat in the rehearsal, and I've sat as in her performance, and I sat in the back seat, and I watched the audience. And it was just magnificent. It was really magnificent to see how the audience were looking at you, to see the reaction. And I've never actually seen that as a performer myself, to watch the audience watch you.
Well, maybe I should say when I watched you. You've been watching the audience, you know.
Yeah, well, but you really had them in your palm of your hands. But I think the key to what you do is that you tell the story. You know, you really get to the bottom of the story. Would you think that the lyrics are the most important part of the song?
Yes, because without them, it's only a tune. It only becomes a song with a lyric.
Absolutely, absolutely.
And the passion that the presenter,
well, I think the music always adds the emotion to it.
Mm-hmm, it does.
The music gives you the emotion, but the actual lyrics are the thing. Then you're telling a story. You are actually telling somebody about something. It's always something that you're trying to relate.
Yeah, and you spoke about a few accidents on stage with me. Would you mind sharing us the story of the one of Nancy?
Oh, yes, when I fell down the back stairs, yes. Well, it was towards the end of the show, and Bill Sykes was chasing me along the actual set, and we had these big stairs that went down the back that goes into the River Thames. And so I was on the top stair. It's about 15 foot, and my shoe, the leather came loose on the front of my shoe. I hadn't realised it had done it, and it caught on the shoe, on the step, and I went flying, and all I thought as I was flying through the air was, I must turn myself on my back. I can't fall on my face. Yeah. I must fall on my back. and I managed to turn myself round, and I fell on the ground. I hit the ground so hard, and I remember Bill Sykes running down towards me going, "Oh, my God, you all right?" And I went, "Kill me, kill me." Because, of course, the music was going on, and I thought he had to kill me with the three beats with the gun.
Yeah.
He hits me, and it was so funny. And then, of course, then the soldier comes down to pick me up, to carry me up, and I went, "Oh, no, please don't touch me." And he said, "I have to take you up." And then when I got to the top, the little girl up there was crying her eyes out because they all thought I died. And then you could hear the kids crying. It was awful, really, because they all thought I died because they were so worried because of the fall. They saw me fall.
And did you manage come back on for your bow
at
the end?
Yes, I came on for the bow because I thought if I don't go on, people said, "Oh, no, no, have a rest." And I went, "No, no, I'm fine, I'm fine." I was very bruised, needless to say, and ached a lot. The next night was very painful. But I was fine, you know, and I thought if you don't go back out, people will think there's something wrong with you, you know, and you're just, it's silly.
Yeah, absolutely.
If you don't go back out for the bow, you've wasted the whole night. That's why we do it.
I know, and there's all those songs you have to sing again.
Yeah, it's all about the applause, Marti.
Yeah, applause, yes, absolutely. Now, Marti, looking back at your career, you have been non-stop since the 1970s. And all of a sudden, 2019 comes along, 2020 comes along, and bang, the world stops.
Yes, and I was doing a play at the time. I was in Darlington.
Okay.
Oh, really?
I was on tour with the Cat and the Canary, and we were getting ready to open the next day. And that evening, they phoned us to say, "No, they're pulling the show." And
it was heartbreaking, really. It was.
Everybody was the same. All the shows were pulled like that, just like that.
Yeah.
And that was it. And so I can remember, it was so surreal somehow. And you thought, "Oh, what do I do now?" And I thought, "We'll just go home." And so I drove home. And it was just odd. Everything was very odd. And there were so many people in the same boat, of course.
Yeah.
I mean, all our cast, for a start, and all our technicians. You know, there's so many people involved in a show. It's never just the actors.
Yeah.
You know, there's all the backstage slot, and there's the front of house people in all the theatres. I mean, it's so many people that are involved in shows. And it's been a terrible thing, awful thing, really, for everybody.
And do you think we have a future, Marti?
Yes, of course we do. We'll make it a future. We will come out of this. I mean, today you heard wonderful news about the vaccines today.
Yeah.
So let's hope that happens, you know, and we can all get back again. Because I think people need the theatre. They need live theatre. They need entertainment. That's what people normally go to at times are bad.
Absolutely.
But, of course, they can't get it at the moment.
Yeah, but it's a great therapy, is the theatre, and other people with mental health issues, especially now.
Yeah.
They do need music and they do need the arts. So.
Yeah, and a lot of people are really putting themselves out by trying to do things. I mean, pantomimes, you know, they're trying to put pantos on and things because they're doing social distancing in the audience.
Mm-hmm.
Because the cast can't, but the audience can, you know. And they really are trying, all the theatres are trying so hard. And please God that it doesn't mean that we lose a lot of theatres. That's the main worry, because a lot of them being dark, it costs an awful lot of money to run a theatre, even when it's dark and there's nothing on. So you just hope that not a lot of them are going to go under.
Yeah, that is the frightening thing.
Well, it's been a long time now. It's been since March, you know. It's a long time.
It's a thick end of a whole year. But what about going forward, Marti? Do you have any plans for next year or beyond?
Yes, I do. I have plans to do a concert, actually, for two nights in Malvern, which is a lovely theatre, the Festival Theatre in Malvern, which is a beautiful setting in the hills there. And I'm supposed to do that on January the 16th and the 17th. I do an evening performance on the 16th and a matinee on the 17th, so Saturday and Sunday. And we're hoping that's going to work. I'm hoping that's going to work.
Okay.
You know, because you have to book things now and
just say,
we'll have a go and see what happens. But, I mean, it will depend, of course, on what happens.
Yeah,
and those tickets can be got in the box office at
malverntheatre.co.uk.
So hopefully it will go ahead. Marti, thank you so much for your time. It has been an absolute pleasure. It's my first time presenting as well, and
well,
I couldn't
you've done
have
very well,
well, thank you, Marti. I couldn't have asked for a nicer guest.
I'm the one sitting here like a nervous wreck. Marti, before we go, I've got two things I would like to ask you. We here in Derry, we are coming down with talent, whether it be singing or acting or the arts in general. And, of course, I'm sitting beside the prodigy, you know, from our very own city. Is there any... What advice would you give to any up-and-coming young actors, singers, you know, theatre lovers that want to make this a career? Any advice, what would you give to them?
Well, I think you have to take the downs as well as the ups, and God knows at the moment there are a lot of downs, mm-hmm. and this will happen anyway. But you have to just have faith in yourself and just keep going. That's it. And enjoy what you do. If you enjoy it, other people will.
Absolutely.
You know, that is the answer. And you must enjoy it. If you don't enjoy it, don't do it. It's too hard a life.
Yeah.
Not true. And finally, a friend of mine, in Glasgow, because you'll gather by my accent, I don't really hail from Derry.
Really?
A friend of mine in Glasgow, a Mr. William McCall, I was chatting to him last night and I told him that I would be interviewing you on, and he claims to be your biggest fan, certainly in Scotland. Now, William is of an age that he struggles with a mobile phone. He's not listening, but he did ask me to say, tell Marti I was asking for her.
Oh, that was very sweet of him. Very kind. Of him.
Yes. So I can now go hand in heart and tell him that I passed his message.
Yes, and thank him for it. I appreciate it.
I will indeed. You'll have just have made his an early Christmas present for him. Marti, we're going to take you out with another of your songs from Cats.
Oh.
We're going to take you out with your version of Memory. And can I just say, on behalf of all of us here at Drive 105, Margaret, myself, and everybody in Derry that's listening, and beyond, thank you so much for taking time out to come and talk to us. It's been an absolute pleasure.
And mine. Thank you so
thank
much.
Thank you Marti. Very much.
Take care, you two.
You too.
Thanks.
You
God
too.
Bless. Bye-bye.
Bye. God bless.
Amen. Burnt out ends of smoky days, the stale cold smell of morning. A street lamp dies, another night is over, another day is dawning. Daylight, I must wait for the sun. I must think of a new life, and I mustn't give in. When the dawn comes, tonight will be a memory too, and a new day will begin.
Marti Webb as Grisabella in Andrew Lloyd Webber's classic hit smash Cats.
Have you recovered?
I'm shaking like a leaf.
He is shaking beside me. I think you're just completely awestruck. You're starstruck.
Starstruck.
She's a wonderful lady.
That's going on my CV.
That is going on your CV.
Acting career. I've
it's
interviewed
going on my
Marti
CV
Webb.
You're going on my CV, Bill.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, you see
radio
the
programme with Bill Waters.
You see the nicest thing, yeah. The culture of vulture.
Well, so for now, my next favourite musical. Well, I've got so many, that's the problem. You see, when you told me to pick lots of favourite musicals, you know I'm a real musical buff. I love them. But